StraightSmileSolutions.com, and today we're going to talk about when is the right age to start phase one treatment and how many teeth need to be erupted in order to have an adequate outcome and not have a lot of time while you're waiting for teeth to come in. So let's go ahead, and I have a ton of videos on phase one treatment. Of course, I have, I think, over 200 videos. I even have a 13-hour phase one course. So all of this is already covered within the course and within the existing videos I have. I just wanted to succinctly go over the specific age about how many teeth should be erupted and also the age. So let's recap first, what is the goal of phase one? Because if you know the goal of phase one, this helps give you some guidance on timing. And I think it's wonderful that patients come in or parents come in and maybe the kid is 5 or 6 or even 7, maybe only have 3 permanent teeth in, front ones, and maybe some molars in the back, and they're like, hey, I want to get started. And that is amazing. And I don't want you to lose that start. And I don't want you to lose that enthusiasm. But this is what I would tell a patient and a parent in this situation. First of all, remember there's 3 different ages. Each patient has 3 different ages, right? And I have a video about this. If you want to learn more, you can go into my YouTube channel and look up age by keyword and it should pop up. So remember, there's a skeletal age, a chronological age, and a dental age, right? Patient might be 7 years, 10 months. That's their chronological age. That's what their birth certificate says. That's one age. That's one factor. Okay. Other thing I like to keep in mind is what grade they're in, because there's certain grades when starting ortho treatment, you don't want to be the first one in your class to start it. You want to be the 5th or the 6th or the 3rd or the 7th. I never, ever, ever want them to be the first in their class or the first family member that they know, because if you have a first grade teacher, they're usually not equipped to handle things like this. Even 2nd is not really equipped. 3rd, good age. 4th, good age. 5th is getting a little old for phase one. So 2nd is a maybe. I usually like to ask, I show them pictures of like what an expander looks like, be it fixed or removable. A lot of times they don't know. And I say, does anyone have in your class have like a retainer or something that they take in and out or something that's in their mouth, you know, that they wear, and maybe, or maybe they have some braces or maybe they have colors. And usually sometimes the parents know, but usually the kid's like, oh yeah, you know, Sally has it and Sarah has it and Brandon has it. You know, we don't want to be the first one because it is something new and it is a little stressful and there's some responsibility and there's food rules. And if the teacher is not already trained and equipped, and a 1st or 2nd grade teacher may not be, a 3rd and 4th, usually they have tons of things going on in their class ortho-wise. They already know what happens if something gets loose or what the rules are and things like that. Remind the, you know, the patients to put their appliances back in if they're removable. I know when my daughter had expanders, I believe she was either in 2nd or 3rd. And I remember I was able to email the teacher and just say, hey, I'm going to let you know that, you know, Olivia's going to have some removable expanders. They need to be in her mouth all the time. Obviously, it's not the teacher's job to enforce that. But, you know, if they're playing with them or something like that, or if they're talking funny, or if they seem hesitant to give a speech, it's important that the teacher is aware of that, because that is might affect their academic performance, especially if they're the first person in their class to get it. I think you get the point. So that's one thing I keep in mind. I like to focus on grades. That's an important time. Or if you're going to get started during the summer, we want to make sure they're not going to summer camp or anything like that. That's not a good time to go to day camp, summer camp. We really want things to be consistent, have a consistent schedule, and not have a lot of variables going on in the patient's psychosocial life. Okay. So that's one factor. So that has to do with grades. That's also has to do with chronological age. The other thing we got to keep in mind is that there's a skeletal age. And certainly if this was a very mature girl, and some girls are fully grown by age 8, well, we need to hustle with expansion, because things that bones are bone related need to be done before they finish growing. So that case, it really incentivizes me to get started earlier on this patient, because I'm gonna have a better outcome if they haven't finished growing. And remember, even though they're 8, they might be done growing. You're probably going to have some idea when you see this girl. They might be 5'3" or 5'4", you know, really big as compared to an average 3rd grader, you know, but that gives me more incentive to maybe start them in 2nd grade, because they're more physically mature. Now, emotionally mature is a whole nother thing. I've had very, very little luck with boys in 1st and 2nd grade, and even 3rd, better in 4th. They're just not emotionally ready for this for the most part. Now, if they come into the office, they sit in the chair, they have perfect hygiene. Mommy's not having to tell them to do things, to listen, to sit, to do this, do that. They're excited. They're asking for it. You know, 5 people in my class have them. They seem mature. They seem like they're following commands and they're not crying up or tearing up. I do not do phase one on any patients that are crying in my chair. That's a no. So, and it's usually the boys. So if they're not emotionally ready for this, we're not going to force it on them. This is not required. Phase one is a benefit. Phase one is a something to help the patient so that phase two will be easier later, that life will be easier later, we'll get a better outcome, it'll be less complicated. But if they're emotionally immature, if their emotional intelligence is low for their age, for their chronological age, then it's a no. We'll recall in 6 months until it seems like they're ready. It's fine, especially in boys. It's really not that urgent. It just might mean the phase two gets more complicated, but you know what? That's not something I'm going to put my staff through, and I'm never going to put a kiddo through this because it's never that much of an emergency. It really just isn't. I mean, it's ortho. Come on. Okay, so all things to keep in mind, skeletal age, chronological age, grade, as well as psychosocial age, emotional maturity, everything like that. There's a lot of things I keep in mind. How excited are the parents? Is only the parents excited, or is the kid super excited? Is only the kid excited, or is the parents not excited? You know, everyone needs to be super on board for me to consider doing a phase one treatment on a second or third or fourth grader. Otherwise, it's a no. Okay. So that's one thing to keep in mind. Now that's things that I can't control. Now let's talk about also how many teeth are in. The reason why, remember, the goal of phase one is to fix the bite. We're going to fix the transverse. We're going to get the bite integrated. We're going to grow jaws as needed, either the upper jaw or the lower jaw if needed. If there's a sagittal issue or an AP issue, we're also going to fix the vertical if there's a habit, if there's an open bite, or if there's mouth breathing or if there's tongue thrusting, we're going to fix that. If there's a thumb sucking habit, we're going to fix that. We're going to fix, if there's deep bite cases, we're going to open the bite. If there's open bite cases, we're going to close the bite. Basically, our goal is to make a perfect bite in all the different planes of space, as well as needed straight front teeth if needed. You know, obviously, if they're super crowded, that means the arches are constricted. So we're going to make the arches be the right size. It's always a nice bonus if you straighten the front teeth too, although it's not quasi-cosmetic at times. Now, of course, if you had crooked front teeth and they were spaced out and after expansion, they were blocking the eruption of the upper threes, 6 and 11. Well, then we need to consolidate the spaces and straighten them. So there's a health reason for that. So then you got to figure out what is your goal of treatment. Always the goal is to fix the bite, eliminate habits, and fix the bite in all the different planes of space. Straightening the front teeth may or may not be the goal. It might be a cosmetic thing. If finances are an issue and it's just a cosmetic thing that can be fixed in phase two, maybe you're going to leave the crowding. But you need to make sure that the parents understand, because I can't tell you how many times it really wasn't necessary to put braces on. It would have been an extra 4 to 6 months. Just a tiny little crooked tooth on the bottom. Wasn't a health reason, wasn't blocking any canines. And I'm like, okay, we're done with phase one. We fixed the bite, yay. And all the different planes of space. And they're like, where's my braces? So you want to make sure that they know. So sometimes I'll, even in these situations, especially if it's not an insurance case, I'll say, hey, this is our goal. Phase one is to fix the bite and get you out of trouble, you know, with bite issues, with teeth issues. So that means we're going to do this appliance. We're going to do upper braces, but we're not necessarily going to do lower braces. Are you cool with that? Sometimes we're going to charge a little extra if they want cosmetic things, if it's not an insurance case. If it's an insurance case, you pretty much got to, I mean, you got to do whatever they want, because we don't want them complaining, even if it's not necessary and it could be done in phase two. We just want to make sure everybody's on the same page with what the goal is. So for that reason, since most of the time it does involve either braces on top and bottom front teeth, or Invisalign First, or phase one clear aligners, you need to time things accordingly so that after we fix the bite, whether we had expanders or twin blocks or, I don't know, bionators or whatever we're using to fix bite, you know, protraction face mask, whatever we're using to fix the bite, once we've done that portion, we're ready to put those 8 front braces on. And if all the teeth aren't in at that point, now we're just dilly-dallying. We're wasting time for 6 months, a year. This is where you get burnout. So that's why we wanted to consolidate it into the most compact, succinct timing so that everything's happening at the right time and it's just streamlined. We don't want this phase one to be going on 2, 2.5, 3 years. That's a complete waste of everyone's time and a complete waste of chair time and overhead for you. Patient parents gonna be like, when are we done? They get burnt out in phase one after 1 year. You really gotta try to keep your phase ones to less than a year, if possible. You know, and there's no reason you can't, as long as you're timing things correctly. Now, occasionally you're gonna have a really complex phase one with habits and other stuff. You know, maybe they need ENT surgery. I mean, it might take a little bit longer. Major trauma, major growth issues. Okay, that might take a little bit longer. Or maybe we have to start things early just because skeletally, they're it's a girl and she's about to finish puberty, so we have to hustle. But maybe sometimes you get these girls that are 8 and they're almost done growing, but they have 4 permanent teeth in. So, I mean, timing is off. So in this case, it might be a 2-year because we got to get started with the expansion and the growth modification component, and we can do the phase 1 braces part after. And there might be a little delay. It gets a little messy though when you do that with insurance, when you have nothing going on. So that's why I just wanted to bring up the whole timing thing. And, you know, it doesn't always work out perfectly, but yeah, so these are all things. So that, for that reason, if I have my ways, everything needs to align in terms of the timing, the skeletal age, the chronological age, the grade, the psychosocial age, the emotional maturity, as well as I like to have at least 6 to 8 front teeth in before I get started, as well as the first molars need to be fully, fully erupted. I prefer, if I'm going to do fixed, to ban the E's, which is your A, your J, your K, and your T. It just is way more comfortable. If you try to ban the 6s or your 3, your 14, your 3, your 14, your 19, and your 31. You can see I'm thinking with ortho brain and not general dentist American brain, but it's really pinchy to try to ban those. So I don't recommend that. But if you wait too long, you can't ban your A or J and all that because they're going to start getting loose during treatment. So timing is really, really critical. If you do that, then you might as well, I don't know, sometimes I just do removable in that case. But yeah, keep all those things in mind so that everything could just be streamlined, boom, bang, bang, do the growth modification component or fix the bite, and then boom, go straight on to your 2x4s, which should only take a few months if you already created enough space, pull baby teeth as needed, and then go into some type of retention as needed, and you're done less than 1 year. That's the ultimate goal. All right, thanks so much. And just to, one other tip. If you have one of those parents that's just like desperate to get started, and occasionally you have someone, they're like, my kid's getting teased. I really, 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 really want to get started, you know, and it seems like they're emotionally ready. If maybe it's a girl, we need to get started a little earlier, not too many teeth are in. You can always start with something, and I call this pre-phase 1 therapy. And you don't even have to officially start phase 1. You could just do pre-phase 1 therapy. Usually I charge between $300 and $500. I don't go through insurance for this. I kind of made up that term, but I know a lot of other people are doing it. You could bill phase 1 and get started, but now it's a 2 to 2.5 year thing. And I just feel like sometimes it's a huge commitment, especially if they're non-compliant. It gets really messy at that point. So the pre-phase 1 therapy, there's 3 companies that offer this that I know of. There might be more. There's Healthy Start by Orthotain. You can get a habit corrector. It's a good appliance to get started with. I like to use that for 6 to 12 months in these early mixed dentition cases, and then move on to my expanders and my growth modification appliances that are worn 24/7, because you can't wear something like a Healthy Start to school. It's not going to work. It's a one piece. They can't talk with it, and it's just not realistic. It's like wearing a Bionator to school. I had a friend who wore one of those in, I don't know why she was in 7th grade wearing it now that I think about it, because I know she was already done growing at the time. It makes zero sense now that I think about it. But the poor thing, she had to wear this Bionator to school. You probably have heard me tell stories. All the time in school, and you know, she'd have to take it out every time she had to talk in class. It was nasty. It would sit on the desk. I sat next to her, and I was like 12 or 13, and I was like, what the heck, this is disgusting. It really left quite an impression on me. So and by the way, I'm still a friend of mine. Overjet's still there, didn't get fixed, of course, because she was done growing. I could have told you that wasn't gonna work, but yeah, that's not gonna happen. That's not gonna work. That was terrible timing in terms of whoever created that treatment plan. But yeah, it's not going to happen. You know, they're not going to wear one piece appliances at school in 7th grade or 6th grade or 5th grade or maybe in 2nd grade, because they might think it's fun. But I mean, it's probably not going to happen. So stick with 2-piece appliances that they can easily take in and out, that they can easily navigate and talk. And if they're looking hesitant in the chair to wear appliances at school that are removable, well, they're not going to wear them. I have kids. They're not going to wear them. They're just going to come out of their mouth, that they're just going to go back in on the bus on the way home. And then it's not going to work because they're not wearing them as directed, and the parents are not going to know. So, and they're going to wonder why you're getting a bad outcome. Well, because you picked the wrong appliance for this patient, or you timed the timing wrong. So just keep these things all in mind as you're picking the treatment plan, making sure that appliance works for the patient. I like to, when I describe it and show them what it looks like, I like to have samples that they can touch and feel. You can call your lab and you can order sample appliances. You know, you can just send one demo. They have all kind of demo models, you know, that they can make an old scan. They can make things off and say, hey, I want an example of a fixed expander, a Schwartz, a twin block, a Bionator. I mean, whatever the most sagittal, whatever the most common appliances that you use. And you need to have ones that, sometimes there's ones that maybe people returned or never picked up, that they can send you they shouldn't hopefully charge you full price if you're making a whole bunch of ones. I mean, I've had really good deals that I've made with different labs, and at one point I had samples of everything, you know, in a little kit with my name on it. And even cooler if you could make all different colors and things so that they get really inspired. If you make them all pink, it just, there's no motivation. So, 'cause I mean, their eyes will light up. They'll be like, "Oh, that's tie-dye. That's so cool. Or this has glitter. That's so cool. You know, this has my team decal." They get really, really motivated. We want, when we show them the appliance, for their eyes to light up and for them to be super excited. Both the patient, I want it to be like Christmas Day, you know, like they open the present and they look excited about wearing this. If they're not lighting up and if mom's not lighting up, it's not a good fit. So just things to keep in mind. Don't force the treatment. All right, thanks so much.